Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strosstown Rod and Gun Club.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Just Say Sports. March 11th, we are live from the BCTV studios across from beautiful Albright College. My name is Rob Galtere. With me again this week, Chris Barto. And Chris, we talked about it. We agonized over it. For how long? And he's finally here. DeSean Jackson is an Eagle.
Yes, I'm glad you started that way because you threw me off. I was going to congratulate you, first of all, for setting the agenda for our last show because you said it at Bryce Harper, and it's almost like you knew something big was going to happen.
Very, very. That was an agonizing long stretch.
Very.
I can't imagine what it'd been like for you know, Klentak and Middleton and you know, the San Francisco people and just the Harper family.
Yeah, a bit of a trying process, I'm sure, but I think we both agree that the Phillies in the baseball world made a really good deal.
First of all, what the people outside of Philadelphia, like the, you know, say, oh my God, 13 years. Philadelphia knows, Phillies know that year 11, 12, and 13, the chance of production are slim. Mm-hmm. It's basically you're eating those $25 million for those 3 years. Now, the salary cap right now is $210. It could be $300 million by the time we hit year 11, 12, and 13. And relievers are going to be making $22 million a year, which is what that cap hit is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we really can't worry about a dozen years down the road at this point. He's a Philly, and that's pretty amazing, actually. Matt Klentak earned his stripes this offseason.
Yeah, he did. Just very impressive. And I was kind of fascinated by the whole contract process, how everything back and forth. And for those who follow Philly's message boards, there's a real good one, Back She Goes. And there was an expert in Las Vegas who was close to the Harper situation saying all along, Bryce wants Philadelphia, wants Philadelphia. Boris is going to play this out as long as possible. I mean, he nailed it to a T. And there was a contact who had a source with the Phillies was saying all along, The Phillies aren't going to be outbid. They're very confident. Mm-hmm. So between the two of them, so when everything else was going crazy, I mean, just absolutely going, you know, the media and these two were very consistent at sticking to their guns. And it was just fascinating read. Every day they'd just be like, relax, relax. It's all good. It's all good. And then one day, though, one of the Las Vegas person said, uh-oh, not as confident. And then the board melted down. It was tremendous. It was a great soap opera. So the Phillies signed Harper, $335 million for 13 years. Basically, by stretching it out that far, it's a low annual cost, and it doesn't tie up the Phillies where they're not able to do other things.
And he's already recruiting Mike Trout.
This has a chance to be something special. Not just because they signed Harper, but because they now have the ability. Harper's given them that ability. Middleton's already made the promise he's going to be spending money to Harper and basically to the fans. This could be a fun run for the next decade.
Absolutely. I watched his press conference from Clearwater, I think, two Saturdays ago. And if it's possible, he was a humble guy. You're really family-driven, and that's what drove this decision, that he based it around family and the feel he got from the Middletons themselves, the Phillies organization, and the Phillies fans. And he talked about last year playing right field with fans yelling to him, sign with us, as opposed to the prior years where they called him whatever you can imagine. And he didn't forget that. clearly. And, you know, Reese Hoskins, JT Realmuto, he said his favorite player in baseball. And all that led to the Phillies acquiring him. Pretty amazing.
Pretty amazing indeed. I'll even go back to you. When I broached this question to you, probably October or November, would you sign Bryce Harper, 10 years, $400 million, and you said yes. So, I mean, looking at that, you've got to be ecstatic how this all played out.
Like I emailed you that day, I said, I'm stunned they got this deal done, the 13 years for the 330, because just like you mentioned, it doesn't strap the club. And I think that was intentionally done that way by Harper and through Boris. He had to say to Scott Boris, listen, I want a record deal, but I don't want to kill my team so we can't win.
Right.
Which makes great sense. And he's proving to be a great teammate already. I heard a story on the radio last week about when he was taking simulated batting practice. And after he was done with each pitcher, he went out and shook their hand, thanked them, except for one guy. He stood and talked to him and explained to him that every time he threw a split finger, he knew it was coming because he was tipping it by fiddling in his glove or whatever. And that's the first time he's ever met these guys, minor leaguers, that he's willing to take the time to help out instead of just go hit the showers.
And that's what they need. They need someone to kind of be that leader.
Absolutely.
And he's only 26 years old, which is the thing you forget. I mean, he's 3 months older than Reese Hoskins. So a lot of these minor leaguers might be 23 years old. He's only a few years older than him. So it's a different dynamic, but amazing how everything was Bryce Harper in Philadelphia. These owners have to realize star power is huge in this area. If you're going to draw, star power is huge.
Just look around the Philadelphia sports scene right now. It's everywhere. Carson Wentz is a folk hero, even though he wasn't the winning quarterback in the Super Bowl. Embiid is just loved universally in the city. And the Flyers' young core now that's coming up, Carter Hart's going to be another folk hero, it looks like. So it's unbelievable how this has evolved the last 3 to 5 years.
It really has. It was a down swoon, but now everything is not just on the rise, but it's on the rise quickly. Just Say Sports is the program. Feel free to talk about anything if you want to join us. The phone number is 610-378-0426, and it'll be on the screen. Lots to talk about with the Phillies. Harper, we talked before the show, this whole new four outfielder thing. And there's a Hall of Fame player, played in the late 1890s, Wee Willie Keeler said, hit them where they ain't.
Yeah.
Are batters ever going to adjust where they can just line drive to left field when they need to?
Maybe if they weren't graded on their launch angle.
I mean, that basically chased Ryan Howard out of a career.
Yeah, you're right. How many times was he robbed or just taken away from base hits, doubles, gappers, whatever, because somebody just happened to be standing there?
Yeah. I saw a statistic. Harper's OPS against a regular defense is almost 900, and against the shift last year was under 700. So that what it means is you've got to have Segura, you've got to have McCutcheon, you've got to have those guys on base in front of Harper so that teams cannot shift.
Absolutely. It's going to be a key. And if Hoskins doesn't knock in 100 runs this year, if he's healthy, then that's a problem.
Yeah, and I'm not even worried about that. Hoskins healthy with this lineup is going to knock in 100. I'll be honest with you. I think Reese Hoskins could win or be in the contention for NL MVP this year, with having those guys in front of him. You look at, and we talked about it earlier, Andrew McCutcheon, this is a guy who when not a leadoff hitter in his career, when moved to leadoff last year, had almost an on-base percentage of 400, and that's 250 some at bats. You put that guy at the top of the order, his walk rate went from 12% to 18%, and then you have, you know, Gene Segura, who's a hit machine.
Mm-hmm.
The team's got a lot of potential to score runs.
They are solid pros at the top of that lineup for sure, and that's a big change from before. Think about Odubel Herrera and Hernandez up there.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Don't forget Reese batting second.
Yes.
Your ultimate number two hitter, Reese Hoskins.
Yes. Thank goodness Gabe got a new iPad in the offseason, and it doesn't say to bat Reese Hoskins second and create the worst year of his career.
Yeah, there was no extra pressure on him last year. Bat him second and put him in left field, a position he doesn't play. Last year was just an absolute disaster. How we survived that as fans. I mean, basically, we needed this every 2 weeks to just vent our frustrations.
Exactly. We did.
That's what we needed. Before, I lots to talk about with the Phillies, and I still want to talk baseball free agency and everything. So much to talk about. Let's talk about NFL free agency. Let's start with Antonio Brown. Not a free agent. Basically, whines and moans and complains his way out of Pittsburgh so much that potentially the best wide receiver in football was traded for a third and fifth round pick.
Mm-hmm.
And the Steelers are taking a $20 million cap hit for the pleasure of trading him.
Exactly. That's not how you like it to play out if you're from Pittsburgh, for sure. And on the other side, the Raiders essentially traded Cooper and a third and fifth rounder and got Antonio Brown and a first round pick.
So they got a better pick and they got the better wide receiver.
A much better player, yeah.
It's now we all fall in that you're rewarding, because as we're parents, we're rewarding the child for his bad behavior.
Exactly. Yes.
And Antonio Brown's the child, and his bad behavior got him out of Pittsburgh, and now he gets rewarded with a bigger contract. It's professional sports. There's nothing you can do about it.
And that's been brought up as soon as this trade was completed, that we shouldn't be doing it this way. He's getting exactly what he wanted and didn't deserve it. And I think the owners will dig in the future not to try to let it happen again, although you certainly can't guarantee it.
But it's not the Raiders' responsibility.
Oh.
They've got one of the best wide receivers in football at an absolute value in terms of draft picks.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a matter of, you know, the contract that you're giving him, and is he going to... Wide receivers are weird.
They are. They can be divas. And I think Brown's even admitted the most important thing to him right now was getting the money.
Yeah.
It wasn't winning. It was money.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, and they're not baseball players. They've got a shorter span.
And it's not guaranteed money.
It's not guaranteed. So you sign that guarantee. Interesting. One more thing with the Raiders. Mike Mayock is now the GM. They hired the TV, you know, the Mel, another Mel Kiper type.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's an interesting case study to see these guys, the talking heads who do all this research and watch film after film after film after film.
Mm-hmm.
Can they compete with the so-called general managers, experts, when it comes to talent evaluation? Now, he goes out and lands a real, real good football player. With him and Gruden, just an interesting dynamic going on in Oakland. It's going to be fun to watch. Or are they in Las Vegas yet?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Yeah, I think there's at least one more year in California. And it will be interesting. And I think he'll do fine. And I think guys like him will do fine in general. I think Lewis Riddick could be a good general manager and has been in front offices in the past. And they hang around the GMs when they're at these combines. So, you know, they're part of those circles. So if the guy's smart enough, sure, why not?
All right. DeSean Jackson, another wide receiver, dynamic and yet sometimes troublesome, returns to Philadelphia for a 6th and 7th round pick. separated in the years. Deshaun is a strange one. We see Deshaun when he plays the Eagles and he looks like the old Deshaun.
Mm-hmm.
But when he plays against the rest of the NFL, he looks like an older, injured. He's not the same player. I mean, your thoughts on that acquisition, and is he a guy? Is he just like another Mike Wallace who chances are is not going to make an impact?
Yeah, I wasn't upset when the Redskins moved on from him a couple years ago, and now we're a couple more years down the road, and he's back with the Eagles. And I heard all the excitement on the radio coming in, and that's great, but the Eagles fans need to realize it's not Deshaun Jackson from 6 years ago. He never will be. He's hurt several games a year for sure where he doesn't suit up. And 50 catches, I think, would be good.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he's got a – they want him to spread the field. That's what he's there for. But the problem is you look at – 2 years ago, and they said, well, Torrey Smith did a pretty good job with that. Well, they got rid of Torrey Smith because they didn't think he did a good job with that. And Torrey Smith really didn't do it until Nick Foles was the quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
As much as, you know, Carson Wentz, and he was having that MVP-type season, this isn't a guy who was throwing a good deep ball. This was a guy who didn't have confidence throwing the deep ball. And was afraid that, you know, Alshon Jeffrey's not nearly as good with Carson Wentz because Carson doesn't want to throw the ball when the guy's covered. When Nick just said, go up and get it, big guy.
Mm-hmm. And you got to get Wentz to look off of Ertz.
Yes.
So it'll be interesting. I really don't see it as a game changer, but I can understand why the Eagles fans are happy about it.
Lots to talk about tonight on Just Say Sports. We've got plenty to go through, but we'll take a phone call now. Hello, viewer, and welcome to JSS.
Good evening, fellas. How are you?
Good. How are
Fine,
you?
Thank you.
Very well, thank you. You're covering the Phillies and the Eagles very well. I just wanted to shift to high school sports for a moment.
Sure.
And I know, Rob, you would be very interested in high school sports. Just a tip of the hat to the only two remaining teams mm-hmm. playing in a state basketball tournament.
Yep.
And that would be the Twin Valley girls, who feature an incredible player. If she were a boy, she'd be on the front page of the newspaper.
Yep.
every issue in the sports. Mm-hmm. And to the Muhlenberg boys, who have come out of nowhere, they're a Cinderella team. You know, they live by the three, and when it's not dropping, they're season could be over. But right now, they're the only two teams standing. All the other teams that get the airtime on EEU every week, they're gone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And another tip of the hat, even though they lost, the Kutztown boys darn near pulled off one of the big upsets of the entire year against that team out of Philly.
Yeah.
Only losing by 4 points. And then the tip of the hat to the Wilson boys and girls swim team and the Schuylkill Valley team. These two high schools, year in and year out, win district titles, state titles, compete for the state titles, and they really hardly get any recognition for it.
No.
And those kids work as hard as anybody in any sport, as well as our county wrestlers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the little recognition those boys get for how they bust their butts year-round, and really it just comes and goes with little recognition.
Yeah.
And then finally, a hope that this spring the weather will be kind to the spring sports, specifically baseball and softball, so that the boys and girls can get their seasons in, their practices in, and get full seasons in before they go into the tournament, because the last 2 to 3 years has been brutal on spring sports.
And it's been brutal on the pitchers, because you stack up the games and then you've got so many arms you just got to throw out there, and then you don't have the quality, you know, with the pitchers. And
right.
It just makes it tough for high school spring sports, and it's this way every year. That snowfall in March kills it every year.
And it didn't last year with that spring, that snowfall in March. I know one team, the boys were shoveling off the infield in order to practice.
Yeah.
So let's hope they get good weather this spring.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks, fellas. Another great show.
Yep, thanks. Yep, take care. Yeah, we could really use some sunny days and dry everything out. But right now, I mean, once it melts and then it's all marshy and we can't even get the fields lined right now. And it's been very frustrating. But yeah, Muhlenberg tomorrow night, having to drive all to Western PA. But I was just talking to Mike Mish, who's the principal of Muhlenberg. And, you know, we were talking about, and I talked to Ted Snyder, who's been on this program, the coach of Kutztown. He says, if you can somehow get out west, you've got opportunities. It's so much harder to go to the Philadelphia area, even though Kutztown almost pulled off a major upset.
Right.
That is, last year, Kutztown beat Lancaster Mennonite. They ended up having to play a real tough Philly team. Lancaster Mennonite went out west and was able to win a few games. So sometimes it's just that luck of the draw, how it happens. But you don't want to play the Philly teams when it comes to basketball.
No, it is really nice to see what those two teams are doing still on the basketball court. And Tyrone Nesby's bringing some serious street cred to the Muhlenberg program.
No question.
Yeah.
But it's and I liken it to Muhlenberg to Loyola Chicago last year. You know, if Lonnie hits the free throws, we don't hear about Loyola Chicago last year. Mm-hmm. Miami might be that team that goes on that run.
Right.
You know, people forget that. Muhlenberg almost lost first round of districts.
Mm-hmm.
They had an unbelievable, thrilling game where they were able to pull it out, and it's just that win gives you that momentum, gives you that confidence, and all of a sudden you start playing even better than you have all year, and that's what's happened to Muhlenberg, and they've put everything together. Hopefully they can pull out a win. Hopefully the Twin Valley girls can pull out a win.
Three words, survive and advance.
Survive and advance. That's why Pennsylvania and New Jersey do it completely different. New Jersey is one and done. There's none of this districts and then playing games. And, you know, you could lose two games and still be alive in Pennsylvania, whereas in New Jersey, it is one and done.
Yeah.
You know, you can be out. A couple minutes left. Sixers look a little different when the big fella plays.
Oh, do they ever. Boy, you can see how they missed him if you saw yesterday's game against Indiana. And I mentioned to you before the show, I can't believe how physical that game was. We're early in March here, and I was shocked that the refs let so much go and how physical Indiana was. And the Sixers held up and took advantage later in the game, but yeah, pretty intense.
Well, that's what's going to be, that's playoff basketball. The Sixers needed a game like that. The Sixers have to have Embiid now with the rest of the core. They've got to figure out everything. And they also have to finish with the third seed because they cannot finish the fourth seed and have to play Boston. They've not proven they can beat Boston in a game, let alone a seven-game series.
Yeah, Al Horford turns into a Hall of Famer against the Sixers every time they play.
And he drives Embiid nuts. He's able to keep Embiid further away from the basket. When Embiid swings his arms and everyone fouls, you know, Horford's too smart for that. It's just a matchup nightmare for the Sixers. I just assume that Milwaukee take out the Sixers or the Celtics second round, and hopefully the Sixers can survive their first round and then Toronto, which would be an interesting matchup.
Yeah.
We're not going to be back until NCAA tournament after the first round. Just looking at it in general, any team that strikes you as, you know, this could be the team to win it all?
I don't know if I would favor a team at this point, but I do like how the ACC is playing and would certainly rank those teams high as far as possibility to win it all. Boy, that's a tough conference to get through the regular season, let alone their tournament.
Yeah, they were absolutely loaded. And as loaded as they are, Virginia does it again.
Mm-hmm.
They win that conference. You go through their recruiting. They're like the past Villanova teams, they're not any top 10 players, not top 12. They just get good players and build them into their system.
Yeah, what do they do that other teams don't?
Play.
They play good defense and don't beat themselves.
which unfortunately in the NCAA tournament is not a great recipe because you keep teams in the game mm-hmm. when you lack great offense. They're telling us goodbye. I hate that. It makes me sad because that makes me, you know, wait 2 weeks.
Yes.
So we'll be back. We could talk Sweet 16 in a couple weeks. Phillies will be gearing up. Lots to go on. So thanks mm-hmm. again, Chris.
Great
for
to
Chris,
be here.
Chris Barto, my name's Rob Galtere. This was Just Say Sports. Thanks again for Straustown Rod and Gun Club for sponsoring this program.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Straustown Rod and Gun Club.